On a cold morning 20 years ago, my father and I climbed the frosty brick steps to the funeral home in our South Mississippi town. It was a place that I was very familiar with there at the corner of Main and Old Highway 84. When you live in a town the size of my Hillcrest neighborhood, you always know someone who has a family member laid out. And even if you never met the deceased, it's only proper that one go to visitation and sign the guest book. Indeed, probably not a week went by in my growing up years that I didn't go at least one day a week to pay my respects to some departed soul and towns member. In the seventh grade, our home economics class made a trip to visit the funeral home. We talked about the appropriate things to say to the bereaved, funeral etiquette, and even a tour of the embalming room. In the sixth grade, we toured the Sanderson Farms chicken plant just across the road from our school. We were used to the smell of burning feathers and seeing the big trucks pull in with crates of squawking chickens. We were given paper hats to wear to protect us from anything dripping from overhead. A worker grinned from ear to ear as he pulled the tendons in a severed chicken leg and made the foot draw up as we watched on, horrified. Another couple of workers hung chickens on hooks by their feet, and we watched as they were driven through a conveyor where their throats were cut while they were swaying upside down. I liked the funeral home field trip better. Still, this time the trip was different. My father and I were here to make final arrangements for my mother, who had died the day before. Right inside the door was the large visiting parlor that smelled like cold carnations, and the guest book stood in the center on a wooden podium. And today, there was an open casket just behind it and a large American flag draped over the end. My dad nodded toward the elderly gentleman resting there and said, "That's Herman's dad. He was a World War I veteran." Herman, Mr. Campbell to me, was the elementary school principal, and my mother had been his secretary. In a small town, everyone is interconnected. It can be quite incestuous. The director appeared and showed us into his office. There were decisions to be made. What flowers would we like to use for the casket spray? What time of day would the service be and where? Clothing for my mother to wear, and finally, the casket itself. We were taken to a large room, a casket showroom essentially, with dozens of rows of caskets, lids up, placards touting the model, features, and price. There were wood, metal, plain, and fancy. I remember my dad pausing at a basic pine box and saying that while this would be fine for him, it was not fine for my mother, and he chose a polished, gilded metal one with a satin lining and pillow. Paperwork was finished, and we left for home. Later in the evening, my sister Mary and I were going to return to do our mother's makeup. Now, this might seem macabre, but our mother had always been a pretty and somewhat vain woman. Cancer had made her thin and frail, but had not diminished her striking bone structure or her coloring. She'd made us promise that we would not leave this most important final appearance in the hands of the director, who would surely use that thick stage makeup and finish with an unnatural pink for the cheeks. As children, we had smushed purple beauty berries into a paste and applied it as blush. Funeral home pink rivaled that color. Besides, both my sister and I had worked at the local Merle Norman studio all through high school, and we knew a thing or two about makeup application. The director met us at the door and led us down a narrow corridor with doors on either side. He paused for a second as if he was about to say something and then just opened the door and let us inside. Our mother was lying on a table covered with a white sheet up to her neck and for all the world just looked like she was sleeping. My sister and I both said something obligatory like, "She looks nice." And then I noticed a tiny dark shadow on her upper lip. Oh, she'd hate that. If there are sororities in the afterlife, that would not get one a bit from Kappa Kappa Gamma. And even more important, when Mama's friends from the United Methodist Church Ladies Circle gather around to inspect her final appearance, the only thing they'll remember for years to come is that she had a little bit of mustache. The director said he'd take care of it, but asked us to step out of the door for just a minute. He opened the last door on the opposite side of the hall and gestured for us to enter. He did not turn on the lights, but with the door open, we could make out a row of folding chairs just inside against the wall. We sat, and he closed the door. Now, there is dark, and there's funeral home dark. And it was mighty dark. We couldn't see a thing, and it was hard to get a feel for the size of this room. It was just cavernous and black. Mary and I started to giggle a little, nervous sort of snickers. How would it look if the director came back and we were laughing with our dead mother across the hall? We tried to regain composure, and slowly our eyes adjusted a little bit, and I realized that this was the casket showroom. Daddy and I were in here this morning. The one we chose for Mama is at the back of the last row. I stayed seated, but Mary picked her way through the darkness to find Mama's casket. I kept feeling like the giggles would come back at any minute, and my shoulder shook from trying to suppress them. In just a minute, Mary made her way back to me, and she hissed my name. Tanya, that is about the tackiest thing I have ever seen. What? I asked. You don't like the one we chose? No, there's a mannequin in one of them. What? Oh, wait, it wasn't here this morning. I'm sure of it. I tried to recall. Well, there is, she continued, and it's got a flag over the end of it. No longer could I suppress the giggles. Oh, no, that's not a mannequin. That's old Mr. Campbell. That's Herman's daddy. Just a split second of silence as we process this. Alone, dark room in a funeral home, closed door, dead body. And then we started to laugh, belly laughs, falling off the chair laughs. The doorknob turned. The director blinked at us and said, "Ladies, this way, please." He left us alone in the room to primp and style our mother, though I'm sure he was just outside the door the whole time. We never did regain our composure while we worked, and our mother looked absolutely lovely.